Moving on. Any questions from the members, please?
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Sharon. I can see how passionate you are about the county that you've been involved in for well over 20 years. I'm really perturbed because as the members of the public are coming here, Chair, and talking to us, every one of them is talking about the lack of consultation that you've obviously experienced from this council. And yet, you know, you pointed out, I think, on page 12 or something, this was an example of consultation. Clearly, am I right in you confirming that you weren't consulted on these charges? And also, whilst, you know, it seems to me, I'm not asking you to agree, but it seems to me that cabinet members of this council were happy to go out to some of the shopping centres and get their pictures taken to go on the front of whether it be the Wirral Globe or the publication newspaper that the council has with people who have businesses in our town centres. Clearly, you know, I can't see the difference, and if you can, please tell me what's the difference in a small business in a shopping centre than a small business like yours within one of our parks. Could you just, I don't think you mentioned it, but could you just enlighten us as well as about how many people you actually employ? Because clearly, if the worst came to the worst and you couldn't carry on with your business, how many people would actually lose their livelihood?
I don't think there should be any difference between the shops and the parks. It seems like the council went out on public streets to get all their good feedback. But do the parks not count? Do we not count at all? Okay, there's only four parks, but there's businesses in their parks. Businesses like me have been there a long time, and we count. And it's only not only about that. Our customers are our friends as well. You know, we become friends, we know what they get up to, and, you know, we talk to them if they're down, or, you know, we want somebody to talk to. But we take that away. What's going to happen there? You should have been out and seen all of us, not just the shops. Why did you not come out to the parks and see us? You know, it's not fair. It seems like we're just being dismissed. You know, it doesn't matter. There are only four parks. We do count.
And the number of staff you employ, so
I currently only employ three members of staff at the moment. I do usually employ more during the summer months, but I'm having to rethink that at the moment until I know what goes on, whether I'm still having business to report.
Clearly, to those three people, it's their livelihood.
It is, yeah. It is their livelihood, yeah.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Thanks very much, Sharon. Thank you.
My name is Pat Gibson-Saxby, and I have been the most tea garden in Eastern Ferries, along with four other businesses. Eastern Ferries is unique amongst country parks in having four well-established businesses here, and unique in that most of these businesses are also our homes. So I am speaking to ask the council to hold off installing their meters until they have visited and consulted with us about the effects these meters will have on our lives. The council have quite rightly consulted with other businesses in Bromborough, and they have clearly listened to business owners and have taken right action. I simply request the same consideration for us, that the council is seen to be equal and fair. Our businesses are just as important and just as threatened as those in Bromborough. Yet we haven't had a single visit yet, not a phone call, not a letter, nothing, not one. No councillor has even bothered to come and see. And because of this, we feel sidelined and angry and hurt. I personally feel deeply hurt, as it was the council in the first place who asked my parents to open their garden to the public 45 years ago, when the council first created Eastern Country Park. They asked my family to provide refreshments for the visitors. My parents said yes, and we've done that ever since. We now have so many loyal customers, but even the most loyal tell us that they won't often be able to afford an extra pound for their cup of tea. Many are pensioners who come for a couple of hours to relax and chat. And we have groups also, disabled groups, groups bringing babies and buggy walking. Many, many people come to us and have done for years, and all of them are saying the same thing. Well, I don't know if I can afford that. And 50p for an hour, what can you do in an hour? That's not time to relax, is it? 50p, you'll be worrying about getting to the car. That's not time to relax. And a pound is a lot for a lot of people. Why has nobody been to see us? Don't we count? But it's not too late, and you are invited now. Come and see the uniqueness of Eastern Ferry. Come and see our businesses and how we all provide our own brand of sustenance and welcome. All of the businesses at Eastern Ferry welcome customers and look after them. Come and see the ancient woods, which are the birthright of us all. Nobody has the right to charge for them. Come and imagine, just for a moment, how the visual integrity of this environment would be destroyed by ugly meters and the uglier yellow lines which would be bound to follow once it's realised how congested the narrow road is into Eastern Ferry. The negatives far outweigh the positives. This beauty spot needs our protection. We are its guardians for the future and for our children, and that would be spoiled forever. Please visit us, please help us, and please pause before it's too late. We will always have debt, but we might not always have our free, relaxing places, which help to keep us all sane.
They say,
there would be lost without you, and that gives you the nudge to open, even though it's not, even though it's bad weather. They're always grateful. They say, oh, with this weather, I thought you'd be closed. We say, no, come in, have a cup of tea. Now, you know, they're not going to be able to afford it. You know, and we never hurry people out. We are a business, of course, but we're not one of these businesses, you know. It's different to that. There's a lot of meeting of people, a lot of interconnection of groups. It's just that it's got a life of its own, really.
Given that your business is attached to the Country Parks Rangers offices, I know the effect that has on the community itself, and the amount of people, just explain to yourself, the amount of people go down there and work and love to be able to say, well, it's such a popular place, I do know it's a very popular place. It's so popular that when I was the mayor, the Lord Lieutenant of Merseyside actually asked to go down there for the second visit, it was so popular. I'm really pleased that you actually opened up an extra special early for men and people to visit. But I think, given that the original Bevington Borough Council asked your parents to open a cafe specifically for the benefits of the be a great loss for not only the community but yourself.
Oh, tremendous. Unbelievable. I mean, they gave most of their life energy to it, built it up, made it what it is, and I just carried on the tradition and added my bits. I mean, it's so precious, it's so loved. I can't really find words to describe it.
Thank you, Chair.
Any further questions?
Can I just say one further thing, because I think I might have half a minute left.
Yes, you know.
I think that we are, as human beings, we are creative people and we come up with loads of good ideas. And I've got loads of good ideas for how to make money for the council. And it doesn't mean stopping the things that are good. It means building on the things that are good and creating more good things. This is such a negative proposal. And it's a kind of desperate thing, oh, well, we really need money, so we've got to stop that, we've got to charge for that. It's coming from the wrong place, emotionally, I feel. And I feel that we should be joining together, up there, all people together, and we should be thinking about what can we do? How can we utilise this? How can we make it better? Let's grow things, not shrink things. That's what I think.
Thank you.
£10 that we presently charge families. On top of that, the council are now asking these same families to pay on a monthly basis between £12 and £16 extra for parking charges, just to take their children to get exercise and to play and train in football. Feedback the club has received from concerned families, and especially those on limited incomes, have said they could not afford these new charges and would have to consider either taking their children to other clubs where parking restrictions do not apply, or perhaps putting out scores altogether. Ironically, the only football clubs that I can think of, that I know of in fact, that are being disadvantaged by these parking charges are those whose playing pitches are attached to Arrow Park, Country Park. We don't know any other clubs that are disadvantaged by this. Our second concern, big concern, is that the council's January meeting, where we just came down to listen, obviously, we were informed about the introduction of parking charges out of park, and it was decided at that meeting that 30 car parking bays were going to be allocated to the car park, the one that I believe someone said down from Champion Spark Plugs, that's the bottom car park. These are the ones that are actually adjacent to the pitches. We would like to ask the council where they would expect the extra vehicles that visit Arrow Park on training and match days to park without causing problems to local residents. Where are all these extra cars going to go that we expect down Arrow Park without causing the problems to local residents or creating, which is a bigger problem, serious safety concerns for the players and families if they're forced to park on the main Arrowbrook Road, which I think anyone in the area or live around there knows it's a very, very busy commuting road. It's an accident waiting to happen. Consideration must also be given to our volunteer managers, coaches and helpers who need access to these pitches, good access to these pitches, to enable them to transport all their match equipment, including what I would say are very, very heavy portable goals. We don't have any goals given to us by the council at Arrow Park for bottom playing pitches. We have to provide our own. We pay for the pitches. We don't get any help in that way. Because of these restrictions in the car parks, if these car parks are full when we get there, which they frequently are, how are we going to get these managers to be able to transport all this equipment? Certainly couldn't be expected to walk down Arrow Brook Road or down from Greece with bags of gold on the shoulders or whatever. It would be just impossible. So there's another restriction. Thirdly, as a community, we feel as a club, we should be encouraging children of all ages into sport, and especially these days with the rising concerns associated with child obesity, health, fitness, welfare, and also the growing problems.
Ryan, you're 5 minutes.
I've nearly finished that, but
you can just
I'll get through that. And also the health and fitness and problems of antisocial behaviour, and not throwing these obstacles in the way with these extra punitive charges of car parking. Wirral is known as the Leisure Peninsula, but this will surely undermine that claim. So with this in mind, we would urge the council to reconsider and drop these charges on our country parks and think more about the welfare and well-being of all in our community that use these parks. Thank you, Chair.
Are there any questions from any of the members? Thanks, Brian.
Thank you very much indeed. Thanks for visiting.
Thanks very much for this good work you did.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you. Could I now call Jane Kerwin, please, the Country Park Union? Thank you, Jane. And could I just remind you?
We have an attractive and sustainable environment where good health and an excellent quality of life is enjoyed by everyone who lives here. This is one of the core principles of the administration as quoted in the budget. I would ask the committee, how exactly does placing, in effect, a tax on fresh air tally with the aforementioned promise? Obesity levels are at a record high, and one in four people will experience a mental health problem each year. yet the daily rate of £2 is being brought in to access fresh air and exercise that makes a real difference to people's physical health and mental well-being, my family included. My eldest nephew has grown up kicking a ball around Arran Park from when he could walk, and he now plays for Everton Academy. I've enjoyed taking both my nephews to play golf at Arran Park from a very young age. They have spent hours on the putting green, chip and putt course and main course, to the extent that they are highly proficient golfers now at only 4 and 7 years of age. We have always supported the TG Golf and Foot Golf Initiative, the professional shop and the wonderful cafe at Arran Park. My nephew even had a football birthday party in the summer with his friends, fully enjoying the course and festivities afterwards in the cafe. How will it make financial sense to take them to Arran Park to spend hours playing golf and foot golf, as is normal for them, when for £61 they can become junior members of Prenton Golf Club? How sad that future generations may not have the same grassroots opportunity to develop an early love of sport. We listened to local businesses, and I'm pleased our new proposals have been welcomed by residents and businesses alike. This was also quoted in the budget document. No, you didn't, and no, they haven't. At last Monday's EGM budget meeting, I witnessed Mr. Phil Davis virtually cast aside the country park petition signatures, suggesting that the council had acted on the majority of these petitions. How can our council leader have the audacity to say this when the country park signatures currently stand at over 18,000? In addition, there were 2,389 individual comments and over 700 individual objections to all of the car parking charges. I would also draw the committee's attention to social media. Having followed the issue of parking charges in country parks from the beginning, I can report that there were swathes of comments from unhappy residents. It would seem these people aren't being listened to either. Why are the country parks the fall guy following the council's climb down on some parking charges? Is it really worth causing such disquiet when in reality, once costs are deducted and if projections are correct, the scheme is only set to net a relatively modest figure in its first year? I would like to ask the council how these plans tie in with the 20 pledges, in particular, one, to improve the quality of life of older people. Many of the people who signed country park petitions were pensioners. Two, to ensure children are ready to start school. Does access to fresh air and exercise not form part of this? Six, to help more people with disabilities into work, education and volunteering. Parks are a community hub for both volunteers and people with disabilities. How do parking charges in country parks fit in with this pledge? For example, I note that Wirral Autistic Society are keen users and of great value to the community at Wirral Country Park at Thurstiston. Number eight, to create and safeguard 5,000 jobs. You're in danger of jeopardising jobs at businesses within, surrounding and associated with country parks. Number 12, to increase Wirral tourism economy to 450 million. I personally collected signatures from people who had travelled to Wirral Country Park who specifically said they wouldn't return if parking charges went ahead, as there were many other options available to them within their catchment area where they wouldn't be charged to park. 15, to increase access to events and activities for all residents. I presume that this would include events held in country parks, such as Wirral Bikeathon, football tournaments, etc. How do parking charges and event fees increase access? 16, to encourage healthier lifestyles through reducing smoking. I noticed on the council Facebook page a few weeks ago a suggestion to go for a smoke-free walk when attempting to give up smoking. How ironic that whilst advising residents to be fit and healthy on one hand, we are now charging them to do so on the other. Arran Country Park was sold to Birkenhead Corporation in 1926 with a covenant that it's for the use of the people of the borough. To what extent has the council's legal department explored this covenant in terms of parking charges being a barrier to use? Unlike other paid services within the park, such as golf and foot golf, the charges would not be a choice but rather a necessity for some people in order to access the park. These parking charges are choices as shown by the publication of alternative budgets by both the Conservative group and the Liberal Democrat group. I would ask whether the council are going to take action following the news that Wirral U breaches the code of practice on local government publicity. If so, why could the saving not be used to eradicate almost finished to eradicate the country park parking charges? The council can find £1.3 million to spend on temporary managers, and the lowly voters have to pay to park at the country parks because we're in such a financial mess. It just doesn't add up.
How and why should they have to pay to visit those businesses? Patrons of the Mimosa Tea Garden Park in the Country Park car park. The old ticket office is on the main road, on the ferry road. Where do his patrons park? Well, they park on the road. The ferry pub has its own small car park, but Marston's Brewery has indicated that it will have to introduce car parking control regulations to ensure that parking is available for its own customers rather than those trying to avoid paying car parking fees elsewhere. I live in the country park. I see who uses the country park and the country park car park. In the winter months, you might get 3 or 4 cars in the car park, another 5 or 6 outside on the road. In the summertime, the car park might be full and the roads are full. What we've got concerns about is what will happen when the council realises that those people wanting to park in the car park, 4 or 5 in the winter time, they'll just park on the road outside. So there won't be any park, well, there'll be very little income from the car parking. If you line it, if you put parking meters on the road, it will destroy this beautiful local area. There's nothing quite like seeing on a busy summer weekend the roadside packed with motorbikes and cars and people who are visiting the pubs and the cafes for drinks and meals and having picnics on the green, children playing out on the green, having family days out, and older people sitting in their cars just enjoying the view across the Mersey, that magnificent view. What will happen if the car parking charges come in? That just will not happen anymore. We should be protecting this heritage, not destroying it. The businesses will be empty, the roads will be empty, and we'll lose that unique vibrancy that draws people from all over Wirral and beyond to Eastern Ferry. There's also the issue around the traffic congestion, which has also been raised. If there's car parking regulations, cars will be forced to park further up the road towards the housing areas, up to a drive. That's something that I really don't think has been considered. And it is potentially a big problem. And what will happen on the charity days? The Egg Run, the Eastern Ferry Hotel organises Glaston Ferry, which is a summer music festival. The old ticket offices organises ferry days down at Eastern Ferry. Where will everyone park then? How will they pay charges? This effect will be huge for these small businesses, and they're in grave danger of losing income and failing. There are currently 45 people employed by the 5 businesses, all of whose jobs will be at risk. Where does this fit with Wirral Council's 2020 vision, which has also been talked about?
Karen, you're just up on time, so could you?
Yeah, sure. Furthermore, with the exception of one business, these are all our homes, so our homes are at risk as well. You know, it's a seasonal business. The winter's quiet, the summer's busy. If we have car parking charges, it will affect our businesses really, really seriously. And I just want to make a couple more points, if you wouldn't.
Well, Karen, your time's up, and it would be unfair on the previous people.
Well, considering,
it might come out in the question, but I do have to ask you to draw it to a close, please.
Okay, so can I just summarise then?
Very briefly.
Sure. I believe that the council hasn't sufficiently examined the practical implications and the additional costs of traffic control. And I would just ask that please, I would implore you, just take the time to just reconsider these proposals and the effect on our businesses. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll just ask you to switch your microphone up. Any questions from members? Gerry?
Yes, I can. Thank you very much. Could I just ask you to tell me what were the points that you didn't have time to say in speech?
I wanted to just reiterate that of all the petitions, the country parks gathered the most numbers of people who are against the car parking charges. I know that's been mentioned before, but it's really, really important. 17,000 people, and yet that has been ignored. We understand that the council needs to save £45 million, that was from the strong leadership decision report for 2017-18. If these parking charges bring in £150,000, that is a 0.3% of that income. Is it worth risking the businesses for that amount of money? I would just also like to add, though, coming back to that point, that in paragraph 5 of that, it does say that £80,000 will be spent to supply and install this equipment. So actually, technically, the first year's income is only £70,000 at best, which is 0.15% of the budget. Is that worth, I mean, a business can go out of business in a year. Is it worth £70,000 for a business to go out of business? Also, another point, there's also a comment about supply and store pay display equipment, cashless parking system known as phone to park. This phone to park equipment will require a mobile phone to pay to use to pay the car park. You know, you're talking about populations of people, disabled people, older people, who might not even have a mobile phone. So they're actually going to be prevented from paying even if they wanted to. With this sort of technology, it could be very confusing. So I think that's another reason that, especially if that sort of technology is introduced, that's going to impact on who will actually be able to pay, even if they wanted to. I think that's about it.
Thank you. At the Select Committee, the overview of the Scrutiny Select Committee, the recommendation of this committee requests officers to develop a full report which considers the impact on small businesses, traffic and the wider community to enable councillors to fully scrutinise all aspects of the effects which may occur of an increase or an implementation of parking charges. Given that view, what are your views in relation to the council's information in relation to car parking charges on your business?
I haven't had anyone contact me at all regarding the implementation of car parking charges. I happened one day to come across the sheet of paper attached to the street lamp in the actual car park, but I've had no direct contact with any council member, any council officer regarding these car parking charges. No one has asked me or any of the business down at Eastern Ferry what the Cllr Park car park charges, the impact that's going to have on our businesses. I think that if such a report had been carried out, if the councillors had been able to then scrutinise all aspects of it, I think they would have found that it would have been completely unviable to introduce car parking charges down at Eastern Cllr Park, because of the unique nature of the geography and the businesses that are businesses in their own right, that, yes, adjacent to the Cllr Park, but we operate in our own right despite the Cllr Park, and yet we will be affected by those charges. Thank you.
Just one more question in nature, please. That was in relation to setting up your business in this particular area. Was that helpful in that you actually took the line from the council?
My property, my cattery was already a cattery. When I bought it, I had to get planning permission to extend the cattery so I could increase the income so I could afford, you know, to run the business. And that planning was granted, thankfully, by the council. But there's been no, in terms of, I have a very limited parking area, and my customers have to park on the road or in the car park when they're delivering their cats. So my business is probably impacted least of the five businesses down at Eastern Cllr Park, but still, I will be impacted. I have to go, and the people who have less mobility, if they can't get onto the driveway, or I do have a small parking area, if they can't get onto the driveway, they have to walk up to the Cllr Park car park. I go out and I help them, I go and deliver their cats, I go and get from the car, I take them back. So this sort of problem may take customers away from my business. I've had a lot of feedback against the car parking charges from my customers.
Chair, can I just point out to members, it doesn't give a true picture of the actual entrance to Cairns businesses off the roundabout.
Just before I bring you in, there's been a lot of mention about the consultation. And I'd just like to ask, a consultation is a two-way thing. Mm-hmm. So although there's no members of the council contacted you, apart from, I'm sure you signed the petition, apart from that,
council at any time, any of the officers, to voice your concerns that you're raising here today.
Yes, I contacted our local councillors, which are the Liberal Democratic councillors, Dave Mitchell one. We consulted with Chris Carabia as well, and we had a meeting with the businesses, Chris Carabia and another councillor whose name, I can't remember, to talk about the impact on the businesses down at Eastern Ferry. With regards, consultation certainly is a two-way process, I totally accept that. However, with something as divisive and as detrimental as these proposals, I would expect as a business owner to be consulted directly, especially as in the 2020 vision under the business priority there. There are commitments to grow and to support businesses, to grow, to increase jobs and help maintain those jobs. How is this process doing that for us?
Thank you. Leslie.
Here, what did they do about the consultation? Well, they weren't even told about it officially. I mean, I don't know how you feel about that, Cara, but you know, really the boot should not be on your foot. It should be on the council's feet to actually consult with you, and then for you to give the response to them, not for you to have to take that proactive part and get in touch and find your local council and do that. I just wonder, you know, yes, it is a two-way thing, but clearly it looks to me that with all these small businesses within the parks, that the council has clearly abrogated their responsibility. And, you know, I would be interested to know if you agree with that point of view. I think you also mentioned as well that there were a number of older people who came down just to really enjoy the views, really. And perhaps you could give us some idea, not obviously exact numbers, but, you know, roughly the numbers of older people that do come down there. And I see them in New Brighton and Wallasey in my ward, where they'd just like to come down and enjoy the view. And now it looks to me as if, you know, it's going to be pay-per-view, like it is on the television. But I think you also mentioned that there were 45 people employed in the collection of businesses down at Eastern there. Could you just tell me how many people you employ and what would be the foreseeable future for the security of their jobs?
Thank you. Yes, with regards to the consultation, the first that I heard about it was from Chris Carabia at the Liberal Democrats, who said, have you heard what's going on, basically? And then I was pointed in the direction of this, soon after that, this piece of paper on the lamppost. I don't receive any newspapers, that includes the Wirral View. Never have received it, never seen it, I don't know anyone who has, and I'm not being flippant, I really truly am, I really haven't seen it, I've never had the opportunity to read it, and I am concerned that there's supposedly £152,000 running costs for this, which is the same as what the car parking income is supposed to be, so surely, morally, to help businesses, that should be taken away, that's another option, anyway,